This was May Day in Lisbon, 1 week after the regime of Marcelo Caetano was destroyed in a military coup. An infectiously happy people celebrated the restoration of freedoms taken from them almost 50 years ago. Two 200,000 people took to the streets, strewing red carnations and dancing with the troops. A blaring chorus of car horns clashed with the chant, "A united people will never be defeated." Censorship was at an end, freedom of speech restored, elections promised, and most important of all, the end of Portugal's colonial wars in Africa seemed at last to be an attainable goal. How did you know whether everybody in the army agreed with you?
Well, we had some signs in the radio.
Secret messages?
Yes.
Two songs. Two songs? Tell me about it. How did this work?
Well, at about 50 minutes past 11 of the 25.
Of the 25th of April?
One song in radio.
What was the song called?
Goodbye. And after that, after midnight, another song, Grandla.
And what happened? What were the instructions? What was one supposed to do when you heard this music?
Well, not yet.
I was on duty about half past two in the morning when I saw big going on the place, you know, cars, officers running, soldiers getting ready with guns and everything, you know, and we expected that something was happening, very big, you know. Then about 4 or 5 in the morning we knew this through the radio that the General Spinola had taken over the Portuguese government.
What sort of welcome did the soldiers get in the streets from the people?
The relations between the people and the soldiers are magnificent. People is always carrying food, drinks, flowers to the soldiers. I think you can see that.
Yeah, flowers in his buttonhole. What can you do now that you could not do last week?
Well, I can exactly say what I think and do what I want to do with no fear of the authorities, the secret police.
What about the ordinary soldiers like yourself? How do they feel about this?
Well, most of us, what our opinion is that this has been a good thing for us, especially what is concerned about the military service in Africa.
The group that has taken power is composed by fairly young officers of the army, that is from major and captain down. Those were the people who have been in the wars overseas. Those were the people that saw that our men were not only dying of a guerrilla war, as the people were in Vietnam, and I saw that myself in Guinea, where I was in November, they're dying of lack of material. I mean, whatever is broken is not mended, because pieces don't come back. That's one of the reasons why Spinola left, because he thought he couldn't carry on a war in those conditions. And especially, lack of food and very poor quality of the food. I've known garrisons in Guinea, for instance, who've been being fed on rice for months, 1 month, 1 month and a half. And to put something into that rice, they used to dry up lizards. And so some of the officers said that we're not only taking our men to the risk of death in fight, but we're taking them to the risk of death by starvation.
Well, no, it's been
out of an absolutely stupid war policy.
It's a grim place from the outside. Inside, the deprivation is almost total. More often than not, the offence leading to imprisonment here was membership of a political group, an illegal act in itself, except during 1 month before elections. One of the men under closest confinement here was José Tangerina, now a leader of the left-wing MDP, Portuguese Democratic Party.
I was in prison and I was in a very particular situation. I was absolutely incommunicable. I was in a very little cellule and I was absolutely incommunicable of the outdoor.
So when did you first hear the news?
At 8 o'clock in the morning, I saw the parachutists autour
around
the fortress. And I knew that the parachutists was the more fidel forces of the government. Then I know they were going to kill us. And 2 hours after, I can confess that I have imagined the cry that I would cry if they kill me, in the moment they kill me. Then I was like this, absolutely convinced that they kill me, me and the other that was in my conditions. And at 10 o'clock, an officer of the parachutists entered violently in my cellule with a
machine gun,
and said, "What's your name?" I said, "I'm José Tangerina. This, I have a great pleasure to know you. You are liberated."
If Tangerina had a pleasant surprise, the members of the hated secret police, the DGS, had an equally nasty shock. At their vast and shuttered headquarters in the center of Lisbon, still cordoned off by the Navy and Marines from an inquisitive crowd, the coup came as a bolt from the blue. There was no time to conceal anything, to fight, or even to attempt to destroy the place. In the maze of rooms, the Navy found yards of banned books stacked floor to ceiling, a black museum of supposedly subversive posters. Up on the third floor was a vast room containing endless files, reports and dossiers, all meticulously up to date, on thousands of Portuguese people.
Can you explain to me what all this is here, of all these ashes?
This is the place where they are put fire on the papers, the principal papers.
What papers were these?
The papers that are more
secret.
Secret papers from the files.
Yes.
When did this happen?
In the last minute.
When
the Navy arrived, they put fire on the.
Oh, the Navy arrived here.
Yes.
And then they started burning them.
Yes.
I see. Are there any bits of files you can see in there? Anything to show
it's
us?
It's very difficult, and now you have no.
Dossiers.
Extensive broadcasting and telephone tapping equipment was found in the roof. The place is so vast that rooms were still being forced open even as we filmed. One, apparently a photographic office, contained rockets, mortars, guns and rifles, ammunition, grenades and explosives. A DGS agent who is caught can expect to end up here at Caxias, rubbing shoulders with his colleagues in cells that jubilant socialists, writers and dissenters quit only days before. Outside, the wives of the agents and their children are treated coolly by the Navy. Communication with the internees is only by letter. The contrasts are extreme, and they're particularly poignant. José Pires is the founder of the Writers' Union. Until a week ago, it was an illegal organization.
I'm 48, you know, and I was born right in the same year when Salazar took the power. And I've never seen liberty, freedom in my country. It's the first time, and that's why you understand that I'm a little...
Is the Spinola regime going to live up to its promises?
You mean if we are in fact free under the Spinola regime? Of course, we have some. I have my reserve. I'm almost sure because, you know, we cannot talk about really Spinola regime because there is a. This is a provisional situation, and you know, this is, as you see, the people here, all the people is against the old regime. So he has to himself, Spinola, he has to follow more or less the people's opinion and people's will.
On Sunday, the will of the people made itself evident. After 5 years of exile in Paris, law professor Mario Soares, leader of the Portuguese Socialist Party, returned home. People filled the Praça do Rossio square.
De organizar a democracia e pôr fim à guerra colonial. É indispensável que saibamos manter a ordem, porque os desordeiros são os fascistas.
He was joined on the balcony by the widow of General Umberto Delgado, a would-be opponent of the old regime who was found murdered in 1966.
República! Viva! Viva o socialismo!
Viva!
Viva Portugal!
Viva! Soares' return would have been impossible, the welcoming crowd would have been illegal, and reporting it on television would have been out of the question. That's the measure of the changes in the last week. A week ago tonight, the censor packed his red pencil and left this newsroom of Portuguese television. So Soldiers still mount a heavy guard on the studios, but there's editorial freedom.
Olá, meus amigos, boa tarde. Vamos hoje, e para começar, a ver mais uma aventura do nosso já conhecido senhor Ben.
Expresso is Portugal's youngest and fastest growing Sunday paper. This is the front page of the last edition before the coup. Whole stories deleted, headlines half deleted to reverse the meaning, sentences cut, even whole pages red penciled. Editor Francisco Balsimão.
The first time I wrote something without having to think about the censorship was last Friday. We go to press Friday night, the editorial. You know, it's very thrilling. You cannot imagine how thrilling it is to stand and you not have to think this word they don't like, we cannot use, then let's put another one in. And for the first time I was writing as I feel, as I felt, and what I wanted, and that's very important. By now, I do believe the intentions of the military who have the power are pure and are real. As you know, there is a program which they have published, which has been published in all newspapers. That program assures no censorship in the press. And by now, I do believe that's what they want. But
wait a minute, you say by now, it's now what, 3 days?
It's 3 days, yes.
And history is full of instances where hunters of one kind or another have promised lots of things and then not delivered them or gone back on their word. What makes you think that this is the one time when everything is going to be all right?
I didn't say that. I didn't say that it's the one time. I said that by now the military people are really sincerely hoping and wanting the things to go as they put it in their program. That's why I think that we have now obtained the freedom we have been waiting for 50 years.
Just tell me personally, as a Portuguese, how you feel now as a result of the last 3 days?
I feel happy, but I am afraid that things don't go for the better, and I sincerely wish they do.
Tell me why you're afraid.
Because of all what I have said, and because I don't know to what extent the military movement and the junta can stay quiet if they start having lots of problems in the streets. And then the people may turn against the junta, and then all this marvelous unity that's going on may disappear very, very quickly, and I think that we should all fight for that not to happen.
So far, although the sense of freedom has been infectious and its expression noisy, there's been no violence. Nevertheless, this underlying possibility worries writer Maria Velo da Costa and fellow authoress Maria Teresa Horta, whose last novel, implicitly criticizing the Caetano regime, landed them in court.
We never had a tradition of democracy here, and the violence can come about because people are not used to negotiate calmly and politically the situations. So we can be at the beginning of a new era of a socialist, more or less socialist democracy, or at the beginning of a civil war.
That's very strong language, talking about civil war.
I don't think so.
Does Teresa agree with you?
She said so, yes, that she agrees with me in these two general trends of the Portuguese emotional tone, both of the crowd and both of the small groups, and both even within our families. At the same time, we feel tremendous joy and tremendous hope, confidence in the junta, and belief that at the time they do represent the legitimacy of power in one side, but on the other side, tremendous anxiety, because we are conscious of the problems that whichever government is going to come will have to face.
The first test for the people and the new regime came yesterday, which was officially declared a public holiday. Fears had been widely expressed that extreme right and extreme left-wing groups would try to bring about a confrontation between the army and the people. In the event, the The largest mass demonstration in Portugal for half a century was an exercise in sheer exuberance. The warmth of the occasion belied the fact that problems remain to be confronted, especially that of the African colonies. Is there a policy yet?
Well, General Spina yesterday in his meeting with the press people, with the editors, he was very clear. He spoke about the plebiscite. And he said that the date for that plebiscite will be established in a very short time. General Spindler and other people believe that the plebiscite will be favorable to Portugal.
And the result will be what?
The idea in General Spindler's book is a federation. And he believes that they would prefer a federation than to be independent.
If the democratic forces in Portugal can help, we can use this word, help Spinola and the other members of Junta to find the correct solution for the colonial problem, evidently the war will be stopped. If not, we shall continue our fight. In practice, this means that we shall attack more in the more Portuguese positions in our country. We shall work more politically, for instance, many actions are being prepared inside the country against the colonial regime. And we shall work more for the unification and the unity of our people.
Have you any reservations, any worries about the new regime?
You know, for the moment, I can't have any reservation because everything is running so well that I can't envisage any reservation. Because, you know, everything depends on the new ministry, the new board of ministers and so many things. We are, for the moment, so hopeful that it's a necessary, I think, to talk, to think on new things, you know.
In Portugal's first week of freedom, it is time only to rejoice.